Bambu Lab A1, the bed slinger from a company that once said no more bed slingers. As funny as that might sound, I think most of us care if it actually prints well or if we're moving backwards and something like newly released TWOTREES SK1 CoreXY is a way better deal. To reveal the true print quality of these machines, I run them through multiple test prints that help expose their flaws. So in today's video, we'll compare the Bambu Lab A1, TWOTREES SK1, the P1S and Creality's K1. Huge thanks to PCBWay who sponsored this video. If you're looking for professional services like PCB manufacturing, CNC machining or even 3D printing from metal for your projects, make sure to check them out with a link in the video description and get 5 bucks off for your first purchase. I like to start by checking how fast and evenly the heatbeds of these printers are heating up when printing PLA. First, the A1. It uses a non-traditional but powerful 1 kW AC heating solution, which is easily visible on the thermal camera. This makes the bed heat up very unevenly, but it takes only around 3 minutes for the heat to spread equally with around 5 degree difference in the surface temperature. Meanwhile, the SK1 bed consumes 300 watts. It uses a traditional DC heating pad that makes the heating process very evenly spread, and it only takes around 1 minute longer compared to the A1. Temperatures across the surface of a bed are pretty even, but I had one corner that contributed to around 8 degree of difference. The P1S has 1 kW AC heating solution that heats up evenly and it takes around 3 minutes for the heat to spread with around 6 degree of difference. Same as SK1, K1 uses a DC heating pad that draws around 300 watts and heats up very fast at only 2.5 minutes with a 4 degree difference in surface temperature. Next, the max flow rates of the hot ends. As Bambu printers don't work with the test I use for other printers, I printed circles in a vase mode at different flow rates and weighed them. It is not a complete apples to apples comparison, but it still gives a good indication of a performance. A1 comes with a stainless steel nozzle that has quite a long melt zone and flow rates look pretty good, capping around 24 cubic millimeters per second, which is not that far from what they advertise. Meanwhile, SK1 flow drops way faster and caps around 20 cubic millimeters per second and comes nowhere even close to the advertised rate. I'm not sure why it comes with a hardened steel nozzle by default, as it has a Bambu clone hotend and you can put these CHT type of nozzles. I did that after running all the tests and increased the max flow rates by around 40%, and the brass one lifted the flow curve even more. In comparison, P1S comes with a hotend that has only a short stainless steel tip, so its performance will be more or less the same as the X1C hotend that has a hardened steel tip. And finally, the K1 caps at around 20 cubic millimeters per second and then drops like a rock. Next is the cooling performance. I run this test with fan set at max speed and the A1 results look excellent. SK1 performs also well, but considering that noise levels are 10 decibels higher, it makes A1 result look even more impressive. The huge problem with SK1 is 5 always on fans, 2 on the printhead and 3 in the electronic compartment. The printer even on idle has an insane 54 decibel noise level. Taking into account that it has 3 unused controllable fan ports, it feels like an unfinished product already. Sure, it runs Clipper and you can rewire and configure fans yourself, but you won't be able to do that easily with 2 fans that are on the printhead. And all this is just unacceptable for a printer that costs 500 bucks. Meanwhile, P1S results with only the printhead fan active looks decent with only small defects on the right side. But with the auxiliary fan, results look flawless. And finally, the K1, it performs the worst, but again, auxiliary fan makes the print look good. Moving forward, we have the extrusion consistency test that mostly show if there are any problems with the extruder and the hotend. We have to judge it by the lower layers, as it is a thin print in the vase mode and the further we go up, the more other variables can affect the results. In this test, A1 results look just phenomenal and SK1 has an ugly repeating pattern that most likely is caused by the gears of the extruder. They sent me a replacement one, but it arrived damaged and I couldn't use all the new parts. The new extruder didn't help and I feel like the results looked even slightly worse, so my best guess is that the problem was with the other gears in the extruder assembly. P1S results here also look decent and K1 suffered from a very irregular extrusion that I tested in my previous video. Next on the list is the Z-Hop consistency test, which will show how good or bad the layers on your prints will look like, as SK1 and K1 had a pretty inconsistent extrusion that will directly transfer to all of your prints, and only the results of the A1 and P1S look good here. Moving forward, we have one of the most important aspects that you should want from your 3D printer, the first layer consistency. In this test, I heat up the beds until the temperatures even out, print the file and measure each square thickness. And here are the results. At first glance, it might be difficult to understand this graph, but all we want is for the line to be as straight as possible with the least amount of difference. E1 uses a nozzle to probe and its results were really good with only around 0.025 mm difference between layer thickness. I usually print with a brim that has just a tiny gap that helps to visualize how truly good those first layers are. Meanwhile, SK1 uses an inductive sensor to probe the bed before each print, and I was pleasantly surprised by the results that had around 0.04 mm of difference. I still think that the nozzle probing is the way if implemented correctly, but these results are definitely not bad, as something like the stock K1 had almost 2 times worse first layers. And finally, the P1S, its performance was excellent with only around 0.02 mm of layer thickness difference. Next is how well each printer deals with vibrations at different accelerations. This is where I ran into an issue where my A1 was not performing that well. I tried different things, but in the end the biggest improvement was with AMS mounted on top plus the additional printed parts that increase the rigidity of the frame and the Bambu Labs fix. They analyzed my A1 vibration calibration log and they said that my machine had unexpected vibration results and provided the updated G-code file with some changes that they might implement if it leads to good results. While they are still not perfect, I feel like the results are pretty decent for a bed slinger this size. Meanwhile, with the SK1 I had the gantry binding problems that required adjusting the Y-axis linear rail. That fixed the issue with no more binding artifacts, but the overall performance was very disappointing. It completely flops above 10k accelerations and the results look even worse than Creality's K1, and I don't think I need to say anything about the P1S as it performs completely on a different level. Another aspect of a good printer is how evenly it can print the parts on the X versus Y axis. I slightly redesigned this test to better represent the difference and rerun it on all the printers. I let both prints to cool down and measure their length. A good printer should have no more than 0.1 mm of difference between two axes. A1 performs ok dancing on that 0.1 mark, but SK1 takes the dead last spot from all the printers I tested so far. Maybe it's because of a strange choice to use those long rods that slightly bend inwards from the belt tension, I'm not sure. But what I'm sure of is that Bambu Lab A1 does a great job with a vertical fine artifacts test print. Here we're looking for those continuous vertical lines on the prints and they show the worst looking sections. I can't explain how SK1 results got better with time as the artifacts were not that bad compared to what I saw on one of the first prints. I even reprinted the model at different speeds and artifacts were only minimal compared to before. But overall the results are not that good as the print has also noticeable artifacts at different angles and speeds. Meanwhile, the P1S results were good overall but not so much when printing at 100-125 mm/s speeds in one direction, and the K1 in my opinion looked the worst of these four. And finally the speed for the Benchy. Here I print at the manufacturer's max advertised acceleration and speed that is capped by the max flow rate. Probably to no one's surprise, A1 does the best here just because it has twice lower max acceleration and it takes twice the time to print a tiny model like this. That allows for the hardened to properly heat the filament and that's why it looks the best. K1 comes in the second place, then P1S, and as K1 results look the worst of all the printers that I tested so far with the most under extrusion on the print. The 3D Bench is also a perfect print to check how well each machine deals with printing the details. A1 is a bit slinger, so I'm not surprised that the text is not readable, SK1 text is somewhat readable, P1S performs the best, and the K1 results look more like A1, which is really disappointing as K1 is a Core XY machine. So, Here are my final thoughts about these two printers. I hoped a lot from the SK1. It has all inner rails, stripper motor, bed leveling and a trans clipper. I feel like this is what a lot of people want, but in reality it seems like an unfinished product with an average print quality. I'm not sure how can anyone think that it's a good idea to have 5 always on fans that are so incredibly loud. But at least the fans are ball bearing ones, so they won't die so quickly of constant spinning. You would think that for a Coax Y printer with all inner rails performance would be great, but it completely falls apart above 10k accelerations. I don't even need to compare to the P1S and how one-sided results are, because even my M5C Bedslinger, which I modified with linear rails and clipper, prints better at 30k accelerations. It is nice to see the pom nuts on the SK1, as they have the lower friction than the brass ones which I tested a while ago, but they use the anti-backlash nuts that in my opinion are not positioned correctly. You want the springs of them not to support the weight of a heatbed, but rather make sure the bed returns to the same spot after the Z-hops and holds that position in place from all the vibrations during the print. Then are the display. You would think that it would be actually useful as wearing a clipper, but it doesn't even have the Z offset adjustment on it. The reverse Bowden tube with an inner diameter of only 2mm makes it hard to load the filament, and the same goes for the intended filament path guide on the side. There are so many smaller and few bigger things that make SK1 impossible to recommend, even to a 3D printing enthusiast that can fix a lot of the problems. Considering that you can save up 100 bucks and buy the P1P or 200 bucks for the P1S and buy a machine that is on a completely different level in print quality and ease of use, I just can't see SK1 being a good value for those 500 bucks. But what about the A1? Is it the Bedslinger with Coax Y speed and quality? I don't understand why they say that, because it's just not true. A1 requires almost twice the time to print the bench chip that was actually sliced in the software that you will use for all of your prints. The only reason the print on the A1 looks best is just because it can melt the plastic properly with a slower printing time. I also wish the included AMS light mounting solution wasn't this wobbly stand that takes so much space. Yeah, you can print the air design top mount that makes the whole unit way more compact, but I feel like this should have been the stock solution and not the one that additionally needs the whole filament spool to print. Also, some sort of poop shoot guard would be nice if included by default, but this is where all of my complaints end. At the asking price of 400 bucks, it is an incredible value machine that does everything for you and prints well overall. In my opinion, it is way bigger deal than most people think it is, as it lowers the entry level for way more people who want a printer that just works and do not want to deal with problems that a lot of printers from other companies come with. Sure, you won't be able to print ABS or anything more advanced than PLA, PTG or TPU, but A1 is clearly aimed more at 3D printing beginners to make things as easy as possible with the least potential hassle. Combined with the multicolor capabilities and the automatic filament change that AMS Light provides, it makes this so easy to recommend for people who want a printer to be a tool that prints well and just works out of the box. If you're interested in any of the printers and want to support the channel, you can check the affiliate links in the video description. Huge thanks to all the YouTube and Patreon supporters. Well, that's all from me, and we'll see you next time.